Okay, nice that you're here this morning. I'm a software architect at Trifork in Amsterdam. And a couple of years back, I started looking into a framework called Vertex. Vertex is a Java framework mainly, which allows you to do asynchronous programming on the JVM. And from there, I explored more different options for doing reactive programming in Java. And the last couple of years, it has become more popular. So we have a lot of different options in Java, and it also has made it a little bit confusing. And this was actually one of the reasons I started doing research into what options are there if you want to do reactive programming in Java. And I want to share the results of that research with you today. But before I start, who does reactive programming on a daily basis in Java? Okay, cool. Who has done some reactive programming, maybe as a hobby, tutorial? Who doesn't know what reactive programming is? Cool, a couple of those as well. Okay, so first of all, why is reactive programming popular? What do we want with reactive programming? Well, if you build an application, then usually your application has interactions with the outside world. You rarely build something that is isolated. And a lot of these interactions you want to react upon. So say, for instance, a user clicks a button. You want to do something with the button click. Or your system receives a message. But even if you send a request to a database or a request to an external service, the result that comes back is something that you want to react upon. So modeling your application in a reactive way makes a lot of sense. So if you look at this from a systems perspective, then this is described in the Reactive Manifesto. And the Reactive Manifesto basically says traditional approaches to software architecture don't meet the requirements we have today. The requirements we have is a lot of user interactions, petabytes of data, your application runs on maybe tens, hundreds, or even thousands of cores, CPU cores. People expect uptime 24/7. We don't have downtime windows anymore. And we need an approach to facilitate these requirements. And the cornerstone of usability is responsiveness. We always expect the application to be responsive. And we also expect the application to be responsive under load. And we call this, the application should be elastic. So more load, the response time should be the same. But it should also be resilient, which means responsive under failure. If one of your components goes down, you still want to have some interaction from your application. It shouldn't hang, it shouldn't give an error, it should give some kind of meaningful result. And the way that you could achieve this is using a message-driven application. Okay, so this is a reactive system. If we go inside our application, we talk about reactive programming, which is mainly what this story is about today. Very simple example. If you have a traditional application, a traditional Java application, and you have a synchronous database API, maybe GPA or JDBC, then you do a query to a database, and maybe your result in 200 milliseconds. Then between your query and the result from the database, your thread is blocked. So the thread cannot be used by for any other application than this. If you would do this asynchronously, then you could do a query to a database. Then in the same thread, you could do a request to a web service, receive the response, and then later on receive the response from the database. So this is a much more efficient way of using your threads. So instead of purely scaling by having more threads, you could also do more work on the same thread. So if you want to do this kind of asynchronous programming, it means that APIs you use should be in asynchronous as well. So the calls to the database should allow to do other work in between, and your web server should allow to do other work in between. And this means that you need to design an API that allows this way of calling. So if you look at the top example, This is how we used to do it. So if we do a query, we find persons by their name, we give the name, and we get back a list of persons. If we want to get their income, we give the name, and we get back the value of the income. We can rewrite this in an asynchronous way. So instead of having a return type, the list or the big decimal, the method becomes a void method, and we have a second parameter, which is a callback. So if you have done other languages than Java, or if you have maybe done Swing programming in Java, this is a style that you will probably recognize. We could already do this in old versions of Java with anonymous methods. We can do it a little bit easier today with lambdas. So basically, the last parameter is a callback. You do the query, and once the result of the query comes back, the callback function you pass into this method is called. And in the meantime, this API allows you to do something else. Okay, so if we would consume this API, so from the client side, we would call the method find by name, probably on some kind of repository, pass in a string, and then the second parameter will be the logic for handling the result. We use Java 8 style lambdas, we use Java 8 streams, but you can see that even with those syntactic optimizations in the language, this already becomes a little bit complicated. What we do actually here is we find everyone with the name Erwin, and then we apply a filter on the stream, and we say we are only interested in people over 65 years of age, and then for each person that results of that filter, we want to calculate their income. But this is a fairly simple example, but you already see something that we could call callback hell, which is also recognizable by the shape of the code, which is an arrow shape, which goes in that direction. So clearly, building your whole application like this is not the most readable approach. So is there a solution? Yes, there is. If you look outside of the standard Java language, there is a library called RxJava. RxJava is part of a larger project that has implementations for different languages. So .NET, JavaScript, and it allows us to subscribe to a result in a similar fashion as you would use futures or computable futures. But there's a big difference, which we'll explain after this example. So the API now, we lose the second parameter of the callback, and instead of a list of persons, we get an observable of persons. And instead of just a big decimal, we get an observable of big decimal. And what this allows us to do is to subscribe to that result. So again, we call the find by name method on our repository. The result will be an observable of persons. And then we can say in a similar fashion to Java streams, we want to apply a filter. And then we want to transform the result by getting for every person over 65 years of age the income. And we finally want to subscribe to the result and do something with the result. And if you look closely, and if you compare this to the previous example, you see that we are actually combining the results of two different asynchronous sources. Because the find by name is asynchronous, the result, and also getting the income. So compared with this, the reason we have a nested lambda statements here is that we want to combine those two results. And that's actually, at least I find this far more readable. This allows us to combine asynchronous sources but still write readable code. And this is only two asynchronous sources. So imagine that you have three or four and that will all be nested lambda statements. I think this looks much nicer. So you can document this in a diagram, and this is called a marble diagram. And the reason these marble diagrams are nice is because there are lots of different operators available inside RxJava. So on the previous slide, we used the filter and the flatmap operator. What the filter does is you can apply a function to a result. So we have different ages, and we say we're only interested in people over 65 years of age. So after the filter is applied, we only get the 67 and the 80 back. And then the second operator is flatmap, And the flat map is a really powerful operator because that is an operator that allows you to combine different asynchronous sources. So we have retrieved all the persons from our database. We do a second call to the database. And for each person, we want to have their income. And you can specify this as a function in the flat map. And now our previous results, which were persons, is transformed. It's mapped into incomes. And it's mapped by using an asynchronous data source. If you're used to using the Java Streams API, you probably recognize those operators because they are available on the Java 8 Streams API as well. So when I saw this and when I saw how powerful this was, I thought, why can we not use Java Streams? Because we have the same operator, so it will allow us to do the same thing. So is that true? Well, apparently the Java 8 Streams is completely different concept than the Rx observables. The Java 8 Streams may look the same because the operators are comparable, but that's the only thing they have in common. Actually, they solve a completely different case. Java 8 Streams allow you to operate on a fixed stream of data. So before you are going to apply the operations that Java 8 Streams give you, you already have the complete result. So they operate, for instance, on a list of persons. And that's why they call this a pool approach, because you pool the items from an existing list. And the Rx Java, the observables, they use a push approach because data is pushed into the operators over time. And this means it's also possible to operate on infinite data streams. So maybe you have a very large result set, or you're listening to a WebSocket, or you're listening to a queue, and data comes in over time, then you can apply the operators, the filter, and the flat map on the items that arrive over time. And with Java 8 Streams, that's not possible. All the data is already in memory on your heap, referenced by some kind of data structure. This also allows you to use asynchronous data sources with Rx observables, something that is not possible with Java 8 Streams. So might look similar, but it's a completely different approach. We can make this difference apparent with a diagram again, which might help a little bit for understanding. So say, for instance, we have an iterable, and we want to transform the items that are in that iterable. So maybe we have the list of data, and we want to transform. Then we have the complete list available to us, and then the map function is applied on the whole list, which gives us a different, maybe we translate 1, 2, 3 into ABC, and then we can, for instance, apply a for each and print out the results. So all data is already existing in the list before we apply the operator. If you use Rx Java with observables and you subscribe to an observable, the data is delivered over time. So we get a 1 first, the 1 is mapped to an A, then we get a 2, the 2 is mapped to a B, then we get a 3 and the 3 is mapped to C. So I hope this explains the difference between Java 8 Streams and Rx observables. Is anyone confused? Need more explanation? Okay, everyone's still with me. Okay, so Rx Java version 1 was there, and now we have Rx Java version 2. And to make it a little bit more complicated, and the big difference between those two is that Rx Java 2 implements the Reactive Streams standard. And one big concept in the Reactive Streams standard is that of back pressure. So you can imagine that, for instance, you're reading from a file and you're pushing that data into a database. What happens when the file reading is faster than the writing to the database, which is a likely scenario? Well, you have to make a choice what you do with the items. Of course, you can drop them, for instance. You can just lose data. That's a valid approach if you allow data loss. But you could also use back pressure to actually tell the data source to present the items to you slower. So you can say, you're going too fast. I cannot write at this pace. Please present these items to me slower. So if you're reading from a file and you're writing to a database, that could be a valid approach. But say, for instance, you're implementing an application which uses a touchscreen. The touchscreen data, you can model that as data that is delivered over time. But what if your application cannot keep up with the movements the user makes? You cannot tell the user, please move your finger slower because I cannot consume your data anymore. So that means that there are scenarios where back pressure is not possible to apply. Well, in the old Java, RxJava version, you just get an exception. And now in the new Java version, you can actually specify whether a source allows back pressure or not. This is implemented in a standard. The standard is called the Reactive Stream Standard. It's not a standard that's specific to Java. RxJava 2 is an implementation, but it's also available to other languages and network applications. And it's the way it works is the following. You have a subscriber and a publisher, which in the Java version are actually interfaces. The subscriber subscribes to a publisher, so that can be the touchscreen or the file reader. You get back a subscription. And in the non-back pressure version, you just get pushed all the data over time. But if you support back pressure, then you can actually request a number of items. So you can tell the source, give me the next 1,000 items, give me the next 1,000 items, give me the next 1,000 items. So you can actually control that the time and the pace on which the items are received. Because remember, with observables, items are pushed to you. So if you request the next batch, you get them pushed to you. So this is a little bit of a combination between the pull and the push model. Okay, I mentioned that Reactive Streams is a standard, and that means that there are also different implementations available. The one I mentioned already is RxJava 2, but we also have Project Reactor. You might not recognize this, but if you work with Spring, then Spring 5 has the Reactive APIs available, and that uses Project Reactor. There's also an implementation for Akka Streams. But there are also a more specific implementation. So there is, for instance, a Scala library, which I always forgot the name from. But it's an implementation that allows you to do asynchronous JDBC operations. And it's an implementation of the Reactive Stream standard, which is only specific to JDBC, where RxJava is more a general, and Project Reactor and Akka Streams are more general applications. And then in Java 9, the Flow API is introduced. So for me, there was another point where I said, okay, what's happening here? What's the Flow API? The Flow API allows you to do reactive programming by using Java 9 JDK, but it's actually just a copy of the Reactive Streams interfaces. So we saw the subscriber, the subscription, and the publisher. And what happened is that they copied those interfaces into the Flow class, and you now have a flow.publisher and a flow.subscriber. So we have the same interfaces as in the Reactive Stream standard available to us in Java, but they're not the same types. They are different types because they're Java 9 specific types. And of course, there's a very valid reason. You don't always want to rely on an external library, but it still feels a bit strange that they were just copied in from the Reactive Streams standard. So can you do reactive programming in Java 9 by just Java itself? No, that's still not possible because it's only the interfaces that are copied. There's no implementation available. So the usage of these interfaces is actually, if you have different reactive implementations that all implement Reactive Streams or the Flow API in this case, and you want them to use together, that's possible by using the Flow API. But the Flow API doesn't give you native Java reactive programming, unfortunately. But it will make it easy to use reactive frameworks, and it also is, it tells us that reactive programming is of such an importance that it should be part of the Java language. Okay, so I already named some different implementations, some different types, so let's look at a little overview of this. If you just do Java programming, blocking, synchronous, no reactive, by just using the Java library, then you would just use a return type. You can do non-blocking return types in Java by using a completable future. So if you just want to use Java and you want to pass an asynchronous result, it is possible to use the completable future. But the completable future is not reactive. It's asynchronous, but not reactive. And what I mean by this is that completable future still has zero results or all the results. But it's not possible to pass data over time with a completable future. So you can not have data that flows in through some kind of stream. It's still no result or all the results. So that means if you have a very large data set, you still have to wait for everything to be loaded into memory before you can do something with the completable future. Reactive streams give you a publisher for publishing data. Reactive streams is just an interface, so you need an implementation. So the three main ones are RxJava, Project Reactor, and Akka Streams. And the funny thing is, they are really similar. And I think even a lot of code is shared between RxJava 2 and between Project Reactor. It's the same team or the same person implementing the operators on both projects. So they live next to each other, but they're actually really, really similar and doing the same thing and even using the same code. So if in RxJava, you would use, you would have no return type, you can use an observable with void. If you just have one return type, then it acts similar to a computable future. You could use the single type. And if you have multiple items, then you could use an observable. If you are using Project Reactor, however, you would use something called a mono, which is similar to a single, or you would use a flux, which is similar to an observable. And then if you would use Akka, then all the types are just called a source. And then the Java 9 versions, floated publisher is used for all return types. So this diagram gives you an overview. The orange ones at the top, native Java, blocking and a non-blocking version, not reactive. Then we have the reactive streams. We have two versions of the specification, reactive streams and Java 9 flow. And then we have the implementations, RxJava, Project Reactor, and Akka Streams. One more difference between Java 8 streams and reactive streams is that Java 8 streams are not reusable. So if you create a stream from a list, for instance, you can do operations on it only once. If you do it a second time, it will give you an exceptions. For reactive streams, so if you use observables, or in this instance, a flux, you can just reuse that source. So you can have multiple subscribers to your data. So if you have a data stream come in, then maybe you want to write it to the database, but you also want to write it to a file, then this is perfectly possible. You can have multiple clients for your streams. So if you will put it in a diagram, when would you use the reactive streams? Well, it's probably when you want to combine different reactive APIs in your application and you want to convert from one type to the other, then you could use reactive streams. So if they are so similar, which one should you use? If you look at popularity, then you can say RxJava, if you search for it online, you get much more results. And I think if you use any API or library or framework, how easy it is to Google for something is a really important thing. Because basically the work we do is we have a problem, we find a library that is a solution, and from that point we Google for specific problems, which gives us a solution with that library. So if you have to find how a flat map works, and RxJava flat maps gives you 10 results, and Project Reactor flat map gives you one result, then RxJava would probably be your better choice. Okay, so we've talked about libraries for creating reactive APIs, But probably when you're building your application, you're building a complete asynchronous application where you have communication with different sources. And the reactive API only works if all the communication is asynchronous. If you have a reactive API, but you do a blocking call to a JDBC library, for instance, your API can be reactive, but your thread is still blocked. So the result is passed on in your observable, but your thread is still not free. So this means that you need more than just a reactive API. You need libraries that allow you to do asynchronous communication. So asynchronous I/O, for instance, or asynchronous database operations, asynchronous web communication. So basically, you need a reactive stack. Everything that happens from the front to the back in your application should be asynchronous, because you have anything in there that is blocking, it doesn't make sense anymore to have all other operations asynchronous, because your thread is blocked somewhere anyway. So a reactive stack, we probably you want to do some REST, HTTP maybe, persistence, file I/O. You want to be able to communicate between different components, so maybe you need an event bus, and you need that reactive API. So the reactive API is RxJava, Project Reactor, or Akka, and all the stuff on top is available to you in different reactive frameworks. And I already mentioned that a couple of years back, I started with Vertex, which gave me insight on how to do asynchronous programming in Java. And next to Vertex, we also have Spring 5, and we have Akka available to us. And there might be different reactive frameworks, but these are the three bigger ones. So let's have a short look at all of this, all of them. First up is Vertex. Vertex is a completely standalone reactive stack. So if you're used to Java programming, you probably use a Java Enterprise or you use Spring. And Vertex is something that you would use instead of those frameworks. It is possible to combine them, but it provides so many libraries that it's not actually necessary. So if you want to implement a REST server, and you want to do authentication, and you want to connect to a database, then it's all possible with Vertex. Similar to Spring Boot, it gives you a runnable jar. So it's not something you deploy on an application server. It is possible, but normally you would build a runnable jar. It's completely reactive. It allows you to use different languages than Java. I wanted to focus on Java in this talk, because if you do reactive programming, then you might say, why do it in Java? There are other languages available, which makes it easier for you. But still, a lot of people speak Java. So I wanted to explore the options in Java. But it does allow you to do Scala, JavaScript, Ruby. And it's completely distributed in the sense that allows you to easily connect different JVMs. And the way it does this is with an event bus. So you can build different modules, and those modules communicate with each other with messages through an event bus. So you can have communication over multiple JVMs, over multiple cores or nodes or container instances. And it does this by default by using Hazelcast. Hazelcast is a fast distributed in-memory data store, which is the underlying mechanism for doing the event bus communication, but it is possible to plug in different event bus implementations. Well, as said, it allows you to do basically anything you would think of doing in a Java application. There is a library available. So you have an asynchronous JDBC library, you have asynchronous or reactive Mongo libraries. It also allows you to do service discovery. So if you build your application into different modules, they can find each other by using auto-discovery through a service discovery, for instance, Kubernetes or a Zookeeper implementation. It's an implementation of the Reactor pattern. If you know how Node.js works, then actually Vertex was the Java reaction to Node.js, to the popularity of Node.js. It was called Node-X, but now it's Vertex. So it's actually, they saw Node.js and then they said, we need this on JVM. Similar to Node.js, the programming model assumes that you have one thread. There are multiple threads available. It does optimize, so it does scale by multiple cores. But from a developer's point of view, You have a single thread, events comes in, events are handled asynchronously. If you have some blocking code, maybe a legacy library that you must use, you can offload it to a different thread, so you can create a worker thread where you put on the work that has to be done multi-threaded, your blocking work, but the basic assumption is that all the code you write is asynchronous and non-blocking and can be run on a single thread. So if you would deploy this, you would deploy different JVMs. You can have the same instances running in different JVMs for scaling, but you can also have different instances running on JVMs. How does it look in code? The unit of work in Vertex is called a vertical. You build verticals, and you can either implement an interface or you can extend from the abstract vertical. And in this example, we do a simple hello world. A vertical has a start method, which allows you to do some starting code. For instance, you can subscribe to the event bus, so you can create a consumer. You need to have some kind of address. So in this instance, we have a hello channel, so we subscribe to all the messages on the hello channel. And every time we get a message, we print it to the console. And you notice that I used a Lambda here, so I'm actually not using the Rx Java API. Vertex allows you to write callbacks like this, or do function references, but it also has a completely Rx Java compatible API, where instead of passing the callback, you would get back an observable. Oh well, finally, we sent the message to the hello channel, and hello world will be printed on our screen. A little bit more real world is you probably want to have some REST implementations in your application. So in Vertex, again, you write a vertical. In the start method, you can create a router. A router allows you to map URLs and HTTP methods to specific functionality. So again, we're using a Lambda style here. And if we would call localhost 8080/hello, then we would get back a hello world message in a JSON. So yeah, pretty simple code, but it's different from things you're used to if you're used to Java Enterprise or Spring, which gives us a bridge to the next one, and that's Spring 5. And I think Spring 5 is a really important step in reactive programming in Java, because a lot of developers are used to the way Spring works. The mental model of how you build enterprise application is how it's implemented in Spring. Spring 5, the reactive parts are Project Reactor. I already named that one. Project Reactor is the API for building a reactive code, so the Flux and the Mono data types. You have Spring Web Flux, which allows you to do REST, HTTP, in a reactive way, both on the server and the client. And you have the reactive data repositories. And if you're used to Spring Data, the reactive repository allows you to create a very simple interface on top of a database connection or a data store connection. And instead of having a synchronous connection, you now have a reactive connection. So you can do a query, and then the result will be a Flux or a Mono. So this allows you to have a pretty simple stack. It's far less broad than what we have in Vertex, but it's newer, so I guess we will get more functionality over time for maybe connecting with queues or other implementations. But it does allow us to build reactive REST applications with data repositories. So we go straight to a REST example. And this should look familiar to a lot of people if you're used to building REST applications in Spring. We use an annotation to define our controller. And then we say all the get methods map to this method, which is an hello method. And now instead of returning a response type or a string, we return a mono of a string. And in our implementation, we create a mono which resolves immediately. So the application of reactive programming doesn't make any sense, but it's the most simple example you can make. And Spring, the Webflux framework, actually subscribes to that mono. And once the data ends up there, it transforms it to a JSON and it's sent back to the client. You can also make this a little bit more complicated. So for instance, we want to have something from the database. So we inject a reactive person repository, and then we can just say, okay, find all persons in this repository. That will give us back a flux, which is again transformed by Spring into the JSON that we want to return from our REST service. You could also do a post. So for instance, if you want to save something in your repository, then you could directly use this to save something and return the result. So the way we're used to programming in Spring applied with the use of annotations to allow us to build reactive applications in Spring. You could argue that the REST example we had is, well, it's not very useful because REST is a synchronous protocol. So if you implement a REST server, you still have to wait somewhere for all the results to come back, and then you send that to the client. So this example I copied from a project I'm working on. We're using Spring 5. And this is a little bit more real-world example with Spring 5 and with the Project Reactor API. And what we actually do here is we send a command with mutate something in a service. And then we have eventual consistency. So it takes a little while for the result to be updated and the result to be available. But we do want to send it back to the client. So we send the command. And then we can use a flat map to send a query after we have sent the command. And with the query, we try to pull for the result. So we say, I want to try 10 times with 100 milliseconds delay in between. So that will be at most 1 second. And if we don't get a result after that, we want to give an error. And if you and return some default value. If we do get a result, we want to transform that into a proper response entity and send that to the client. So this is, if you were using Project Reactor and Spring 5, this is probably what your code will end up looking, which I think is quite a readable approach. You have to get used to it, but when you know how the operators work, it allows you to build complicated concepts like retry and error handling in quite a readable way. Okay, the third one is Akka. And Akka is quite different from Vertex and Spring. Spring 5 is how we used to do development. Vertex is an unopinionated event-driven model. And Akka is actually quite an opinionated event-driven model. They use the actor model, and the actor model prescribes how you should build applications by using actors. It's mainly used in the Scala world, but the Java API is up to date with the Scala API, so you should have the same functions. And it's completely message-driven. It looks a lot like Vertex. Instead of verticals, we have actors. Actors have a mailbox. And they can send messages to each other. An actor has to protect its own state. An actor has behavior. And Akka allows you to build really complicated applications by using actor hierarchies. So it's actually possible to say the message comes in at one actor, it distributes work to different actors, they come back with a result, it's aggregated. But also, maybe they try to distribute work and some actors are unavailable. They can pass it on to other actors. So you have a lot of options there to build complicated distributed systems. But as a difference to Vertex, Vertex allows you to make a real big mess of your applications. I think Akka, because of the actor model, gives you a lot of more of a framework so that your applications stay maintainable. And you can see this in the code as well. If you think about the Vertex example where we implemented the vertical, we only had a start method, and from there we were on our own. If you implement an actor, you can actually have a pre-start, so you can do something before the start, but you can also define what happens when you receive a message. And with Vertex, you had to subscribe to your event bus yourself. So this is again a Hello World implementation, but then in Akka. We create an actor, we subscribe to it, and then we send a message to it, which is written to the screen. Akka allows you also to do HTTP. So similar to Vertex, you can spin up a new HTTP server by using a programmatic approach, not by using annotations like Spring. You create a route, and once the route is called, so slash hello, it will give you a hello world. So back to the usability. Again, if we build applications and they live for a longer period of time and different people work on them, it should be possible to look for results online. And Akka is actually pretty popular, and that's also because it's from the three frameworks, it's the oldest one. Spring 5 was only released November last year. Vertex is a couple of years old, and Akka, I think it's already 10 years old, so it has a lot of history. There is one thing only. Most of the solutions you will find if you look for Akka solutions will be in Scala. This is not a big of a problem. If you know how to read Scala, then you could say, okay, look at the API, look at the Java version. But it doesn't allow you to just copy code out of Stack Overflow and your solution is there. You have to do some thinking. So basically, my opinion is I had the most fun with Vertex. I did a project with it, but it's really easy to make a mess because it gives you so much freedom. It's really unopinionated. It allows you to build applications without directive data types. You can use callbacks. And I also experienced that if you have a lot of junior developers on your team, for them it's really hard to grasp how Vertex actually works. Then Spring is, I think, the most practically achievable. If you used to building applications with Spring, then the reactive version is almost similar to the non-reactive version. So you can just jump from the one to the other without a big mental difference. You, of course, write asynchronous code. It's something that you have to be aware of. You cannot write blocking code, but all the stuff with the annotations we're used to makes it very easy to build applications. It's, however, functionally far less complete. Vertex, there are a lot of libraries. It was completely aimed at building asynchronous systems. Spring has legacy. If you've worked with Spring for a longer period, or even now, you still get XML solutions to your Spring problem. So if you look how to inject some kind of bean or how to get maybe an interceptor, there are still XML solutions available where you probably would like to use the annotation version. Well, the same will probably happen if you look for how do I do a post request with Spring, you get the synchronous solution. So you have to look for something like Spring Webflux post or Spring 5 post or Spring Reactor post. So looking for solutions, if you do a Vertex query, it will give you the asynchronous solution. If you do a Spring query on Google, you have to be aware that you can get legacy. And then finally, Akka is the one I have I don't have the project experience with. For me, it was completely different how I'm used to working, and I've spoken with Akka developers, and they say, yeah, well, if you do distributed programming, it's really interesting to look into, but I think it's mainly interesting if you want to switch to Scala, because the Java library is functionally complete, but all the people using Akka do it in Scala, so you might want to switch. And if you think about switching languages, then maybe Java or the JVM might not be the best language for reactive programming. Okay, in conclusion, if you think about reactive programming in Java, And then basically you need an API that allows you to build reactive constructs. So you have a choice between RxJava, Project Reactor, and maybe Akka Streams. The choice is not purely isolated. It is actually related to which framework you want to use. So say, for instance, you want to go with Spring. It is possible to use RxJava, but the default is to use Project Reactor. So if you're going to use Spring with RxJava, you're probably on your own. Vertex allows you to do callbacks, but there's also a completely RxJava version available. But it does mean that if you want to do reactive with Vertex, that you have to use the RxJava version. If you want to use Project Reactor, you have to convert. And the same thing is for Akka. If you want to go with Akka, then you have to use the Akka Streams implementation which comes with Akka. All in all, I think if you are interested in reactive programming and you have a good case, so you have an application with a lot of asynchronous communication, then it makes sense to go into reactive programming. I wouldn't say by default I'm going to build everything reactive, because it is a switch. The way you write code, it's different. The way you select your libraries is different. You cannot pick any synchronous library and use that in your application without any adjustment. But if you're going to do reactive programming, please or asynchronous programming, please invest time in one of the frameworks and one of the APIs, because React asynchronous programming with just completable futures or callbacks, I think it will be unreadable. Okay, so in conclusion, reactive programming in Java, it's hot, it's possible, and these are the tools that I can give you to go and explore reactive programming in Java. Any questions? Yes. Okay, the question is, are there any implementations for Java persistence with an asynchronous API? You mean GPA or JDBC? GPA. For GPA, not that I know of. For JDBC, yes. There are different options available. Yeah?
Can you compare the debuggability of these things? How hard is to debug something used by using RxJava or RxStream?
Okay, so the question is, can I compare debuggability? This is a good question, because asynchronous code is harder to debug than synchronous code in general. And I've from the ones I used, I don't see a big difference between them. So the RxJava and Project Reactor are so similar that I don't think there is a big difference if you run into a problem and you have to find the solution. So I don't see a big difference between those. What are we going to do with the Flow API? I hope that we will get an implementation of the Flow API, which allows us to do reactive constructs without any library. But for now, it allows you to convert between different reactive types. So there are all kinds of, if your library implements it, there are converters available. So you could go, for instance, from monos to observables, or to singles, and from flux to observables by using that. And we will also see probably other implementations in the future, which you have to add as a library. I think this is it. If you have more questions, you can come up to me after the talk.